If you've seen enough rom-coms, you'll be able to easily predict the outcome of each one. Whether there's a meet-cute, friends to lovers, or
where the girls have just been through a big breakup and she swears off men and then she meets the man of her dreams, but she doesn't know it's him at first because she hates him. But it grows into love, and then near the end, he screws up a little. Not enough to where he can't redeem himself, but big enough to where they break up. And then he remembers she's attending a dressy event, so he shows up and in front of everyone, he tells her, "I really do love you," and everyone applauds, and he says, I got nervous.
We all know that the two lovers will end up together. Most movies are predictable if you've seen enough in their genre. Superheroes will end up defeating the villain. Coming-of-age movies will probably end with a Logan Lerman equivalent standing on the roof of a car with Heroes by David Bowie playing in the background. And if you're in a horror movie and happen to be looking in the mirror, don't. Most of the worlds created by writers are fairly similar, so most movies and TV shows in the same genre tend to look the same. For example, people find it harder to suspend their disbelief when seeing a person of color set in a medieval show than they do seeing dragons, elves, or some other fantastical element in the same setting. Society has a set of rules for every piece of content we consume. In the case of the Middle Ages, it's completely acceptable to see fantastical elements, but seeing people of color, on the other hand, are not in line with these rules. In this video, I will be exploring the ways in which we have falsely remembered the Middle Ages and the implications of this in society today. I will specifically look into how the medieval era is represented in media and the ways in which our version of the medieval era is a reflection of our society rather than that of society at the time. To understand why this occurs, we first need to understand the Middle Ages in the current social context and how our perception of them is a reflection of our values and culture rather than those of the world at the time. First, we must look at the Romantic Revival, which was brought upon by the Industrial Revolution. By definition, Romanticism is an 18th century movement in the arts and literature that emphasized nature, imagination, emotion, and the individual. Though I am somewhat biased, as this is what I study, the Industrial Revolution was one of the most impactful changes in human history. It turned the world away from handicraft and agricultural economies to, quite literally, a powerhouse of production and innovation. People started flocking to urban areas, the population soared, and suddenly the wealth was controlled by the working class, not the ruling class. Nearly every facet of society was affected by industrialization, and many old customs and practices were crumbling at their feet during this time. Humans are nostalgic creatures, so it is easy to understand why romantic thinkers, perhaps unable to process the massive changes happening at the time, rebelled against the artificial landscape before them and sought to return to a more authentic and natural time. To them, this meant going back to the Middle Ages. Well, not actually, of course. Rather, many Romantic artists were heavily influenced by medieval poetry and art. Romantics rejected classical Greek and Roman works, and instead praised medieval anti-Roman heroes like Siegfried or King Arthur. According to the authors of Devil's Historian, How Modern Extremists Abuse the Medieval Past, Amy Kaufman and Paul Sturdivant, many Romantics believe that the medieval past was the truest, strongest, and purest spirit of the European people. With this, we start to see the rise of nationalism spread across Europe. More importantly, along with nationalist beliefs, an ideology that relies on defining a people through factors such as race, culture, religion, and language, we see the rise of racism and anti-Semitism spread throughout Europe. The Middle Ages were bleached through literature and art, depicting them as a white, agrarian utopia. Famous works of literature at the time, such as Sir Walter Scott's Ivanhoe, perpetuated the chivalrous romantic standard that we see in most medieval-esque literature, i.e., the damsel in distress saved by the knight in shining armor from a fire-breathing dragon or evil witch. With this came the erasure of non-Eurocentric medieval history, and even that of non-white European medieval history. Suddenly, only white people were entitled to the Middle Ages, to legacy, and even to history. Nowadays, the medieval era is one of the most popular historical eras represented in television, movies, books, and even video games. Devil's Historians noted that you could spend a lifetime playing in the Middle Ages without once setting foot in a museum or historical site. And they were right. Our society has an odd, fantastical fascination with the era. Some of the most popular fantasy franchises of our time, think Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings, Game of Thrones, are all medieval-esque. What else is important to note about all these franchises is the fact that they feature a largely white cast, once again playing into the whitewashed fantasy of the medieval ages. The truth is, the medieval era that many of us are accustomed to, i.e. the one we see at Renaissance fairs or in the backdrop of video games, is near complete fiction. Perhaps that is why we, as viewers, hardly bat an eye when we see centaurs and magical potions in medieval-based shows. Point blank being that we don't see witches or wizards running around Jane Austen's England or World War II romance stories. Magical elements are as foreign to these time period dramas as diversity is to the medieval era. Since the Romantic movement in the 18th and 19th century, the Middle Ages has been used as a backdrop to the desires of our backward society. People often prefer to believe human progress is on a linear scale. Specifically, most of us assume the time we currently live in, when tangled in a web of oversharing, isolation, fake news, injustice, and hypocrisy, is the most advanced, therefore the best time to live in. This argument is most flawed when one looks at social progress. As unsettling as it may be, many social and political issues regarding race, gender, and religion are modern problems more than they are medieval ones. For example, Romantics literally painted medieval women out to be submissive and pure in medieval-inspired content. They are depicted as docile, naive, and ignorant creatures. These traits, however, are not reflective of medieval values any more so than they are of the ideal Victorian woman. In fact, many medieval women were aware of the oppression they faced and fought back against it. Working-class women took up many of the same professions as their male counterparts. They were blacksmiths, artists, poets, brewers, innkeepers, textile workers, farmers, chefs, and that is just to name a few. And upper-class women were often educated and even held positions of power within the church. Our point is that medieval women doing things that seem extraordinary in patriarchal times is the rule, not the exception. For most people, movies and televisions are the only exposure they have to different areas of history after graduating high school. For the most part, the stories told from the Middle Ages are white, male, and Christian. Yes, this is basically just the Crusades. Because society solely focused on medieval era around Europe, audiences find it harder to suspend their disbelief when they see an actor of color play a character other than a maid or a servant, or is even represented at all during this time period. Even more so, the world was not segregated at the time, despite us having been led to believe that it was. Typically, when people of color are featured in these stories, they are completely foreign to the protagonist or secluded away in their own tribe. In more recent years, the push for diversity has taken center stage in many Hollywood debates. Instead of stories that feature people of color in leading roles and break away from the Eurocentric mold we are all accustomed to, Hollywood has started casting people of color in the roles of white historical figures, which wash away their social and political past, or a fictional character that was written by and for a white person. One of the most recent and popular examples of this occurring is in Netflix's instant hit Bridgerton. The show, based off the book series of the same name by author Julia Quinn, quickly became Netflix's most popular show with over 82 million accounts tuning in after 1 month of its release. Unlike other shows of its kind, Bridgerton has a number of people of color playing leading roles in the Regency-based drama about the British aristocracy. Although the characters in the books were all white, the show took its own liberty to feature a diverse cast, with both leading and supporting characters played by people of color. The character that caught my attention was Queen Charlotte, played by Golda Rochevelle. As a lover of English history, and given the nature of the show, it was not at all surprising to me that they cast a black woman to play Queen Charlotte. Many historians believe that the actual Queen Charlotte had some African ancestry, which is the reason why the show's creator, Chris Van Dunsen, chose to cast a black woman in this role. In the show, Queen Charlotte is witty, stubborn, and glamorous. Despite, of course, being one of the only characters dressed in 1780s, 90s fashion, while everyone else is dressed fashionably for 1813 when the show was based. It honestly doesn't make any sense as to why the queen, the top of society, would be dressing 20 to 30 years behind everyone else, but I digress. In real life, Queen Charlotte was an influential political figure that helped rule the English Empire, which promoted colonialism and slavery. The supposed man who opened his heart to women of color and brought together two societies, a fact we learn after this horrendously written plot point.
Look at our us, allowing us to become. We were two separate societies, divided by color, until a king fell in love with one of us. Love, your grace, conquers all.
I believe that remains to be seen. The king may have chosen his queen. He may have elevated us from novelties in their eyes to now dukes and royalty. And at that same whim, he may just as easily change his mind. A mind, as we all know, that is hanging on by one very loose and tenuous thread. So no, I am sorry, Lady Danbury. We are in disagreement here. Love changes nothing.
Was a real historical figure. One who, in fact, was vehemently opposed to the abolition of slavery and whose reign saw over 1.6 million people taken into slavery. Being as there is not much content on Queen Charlotte, her wrongdoings and that of the English Empire at the time are washed away. In fact, it is easy to see how one's first assumption would be that her character, who is once again not just a character but a person, cannot be racist as she herself is a person of color. But then to cast her as a white woman would have taken an opportunity out of the very limited pool of opportunities for POC actors and actresses away from a person of color. It's an incredibly tricky situation. This falls under the debate of colorblind casting. By definition, colorblind casting is the process in which race isn't mentioned or seriously considered. On one hand, colorblind casting has opened the door for more complex, rich, often historical roles that have typically gone to white actors in the past for people of color. But it is not without its faults. Journalist Diep Tran said, "Colorblind casting is dangerous in the same way the phrase, I don't see race, is dangerous. It negates the very real structural hindrances that block actors of color from the same opportunities as white actors, like low pay in the theater industry, a lack of roles that are ethnically specific that actors of color can play, and unconscious bias on the part of white theaters and casting directors." What happens more and more often is that people of color are cast in roles either originally written for a white person or one that depicts a historical figure who happened to be white. The most obvious example of this is the Broadway hit Hamilton. In the show, a retelling of the founding of the United States through the perspective of Alexander Hamilton, nearly every leading character, excluding King George III, is played by an actor or actress of color. The show, quite literally, turned the world upside down as it told the story of Alexander Hamilton's life through hip-hop and rap, all sung and performed by actors of color. Now, before I begin, let me just say that I absolutely love Hamilton, and I have every word ingrained in my brain. That being said, there are some issues that arise when the media dilutes the racist and prejudices aspects of a historical figure through casting a person of color in their role. For example, nearly all founding fathers owned slaves, an issue only briefly mentioned in the musical. As a viewer, I can suspend my disbelief while watching Hamilton and see the characters as vehicles of which to tell a story about immigration, overcoming circumstances, and the founding of our country. The reason I'm able to do this is because I've already been taught about George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, John Adams, etc. in school. But if we were to take a time period like the Middle Ages, which is 100% safe to assume is not taught in every classroom, the situation becomes more nuanced. Not only do we, as a general society, not know as much about the Middle Ages as we do of other time periods, but the stuff we do know is riddled with inaccuracies from a racialized legacy. Even with or without the historical knowledge of the background of a historical figure, the use of colorblind casting in these roles is an extremely controversial topic. Legendary playwright August Wilson spoke about colorblind casting in his 1995 speech, On the Ground from Which I Stand. He said, "Colorblind casting is an aberrant idea that has never had any validity other than as a tool of the cultural imperialists who view their American culture, rooted in the icons of European culture, as beyond reproach in its perfection." One of the biggest issues we see with colorblind casting today is the fact that the media uses it as an excuse not to include diverse stories. Instead, we see people of color cast in roles written by and for white people. Diversity means more than just physical appearance, particularly when discussing historical dramas. This completely erases non-Eurocentric culture and stories. Now, this is not to say that every European-based historical drama should no longer be casting people of color, but rather that having European-based historical dramas shows be the vast majority of historical content people consume perpetuates this idea that only white people are entitled to history and legacy. Bridgerton was such a huge hit because for a long time, people of color have been excluded from the glamorous on-screen world of ruffled dresses and gold-rimmed plates. However, Marlene L. Dott wrote, "Paired romances like Bridgerton are designed to appeal to those who seek to lose themselves in the sumptuous visual pleasures characteristically offered in representations of 19th British royalty on screen. While I understand the impulse many Black people share to see ourselves represented in this drama that has traditionally excluded us, contrary to what television usually features, an awe-inspiring world of Black nobility did actually exist in the 19th century. From the years 1811 to 1820, Henry Christoph, excuse my horrible pronunciation, a former general of the Haitian Revolution, was Haiti's first and last king. That is to say, Black people were occupying towering castles, glamorous balls, and beautiful gowns. So then Dot begs the question, if people want to see Black aristocracy on screen, then why not just put them in 19th century Haiti where they really lived? The issue with Bridgerton is that people feel content with the amount of progress or representation they've done and are ready to just end it right there. Instead, shows like Bridgerton should only be a starting point, not the destination. We now must ask ourselves how we can tell diverse stories rather than just showing diversity. In August Wilson's same speech from before, On the Ground from Which I Stand, he said, "We want you to see us. We are Black and beautiful. We are not patrons of the linguistic environment that would have us as unqualified and violators of public regulations. We are not ashamed. We have an honorable history in the world of men. We come from a long line of honorable people with complex codes of ethics and social discourse, who devised myths and systems of cosmology and systems of economics, and who were themselves part of a long social and political history." But let's take a look back at shows that are set in the medieval era. One of the most notable examples of colorblind casting in historical shows set in the medieval period is Merlin, a fantasy drama that revisits the story of King Arthur and his wizard Merlin. The role of Guinevere, or Gwen as she is referred to in the show, was played by actress Angel Colby. The original Welsh form of the name Guinevere, Gwenifar, please excuse my horrific pronunciation, can be loosely translated to the White Enchantress. Gwen's character breaks the stereotype that many Black women have been placed on them in media and culture. That is, the sassy, loud, outspoken, often hypersexualized side character to their white counterpart. Gwen, initially, is shy, sweet, and awkward. Right after the show's release, blogger Zara with a Z wrote, "The writer said that the Black girl next door, who is constantly being overlooked in favor of a glamorous white woman, is going to grow up to become one of the great romance heroines of all time and the focus of the most legendary love triangle in Western literature." However, it is important to note that even her character fell into these stereotypes. Mainly, they introduced her as a maid and daughter of a blacksmith. Throughout the first season, her character was consistently sidelined and given significantly less airtime and attention than her white male counterparts. The show brushed over her father's death and often left Gwen to metaphorically and literally clean up the messes her white characters had left. Zara with the Z went on to say, "I don't want to forget that all of these things are reoccurring tropes of racism and that they shape what real people of color have to face in a white-dominated world far beyond the range of this show. I do want to hold on to what is lovely and counter-stereotype in Gwen's character. For me, seeing Gwen mature into a woman, sadder, stronger, and more willing to stand up for herself and her beliefs, has been for me one of the show's greatest pleasures. Gwen, as she has evolved past her shyness, hasn't become a stereotype. She is exactly as I would imagine a shy young girl who slowly gains confidence in a fiercely dangerous world." Even in a show like Merlin, that should be noted, had aired its first episode over 13 years ago, which was praised for its use of colorblind casting and diversity, only featured a handful of POC actors out of dozens and dozens. In more recent times, medieval-esque hits, such as Game of Thrones, have been criticized for its lack of diversity. There are only a handful of POC characters in the show, two of which were major roles. Missandei and Grey Worm were two liberated slaves who became advisors to Daenerys, the one who freed them. it should be noted that they form a romantic relationship on the show, a common trope seen in the media where two people of the same race are cast off together. One of the other people of color on the show is Khal Drogo, played by Jason Momoa. There is a scene in which Drogo rapes Daenerys, a very classic European beauty ideal. The barbaric, untamed man of color raping a pure white woman is a racist trope that has been used in art and society for several centuries. In an interview with Daily Beast from March 2017, the showrunners of Game of Thrones defended the violent nature of the show. They said, "It is not our world, but it is a real world, and it's a violent world, a more brutal world. It's a world where these horrible things are definitely pervasive elements of their lives and their cultures. We felt that shying away from these things would be doing a disservice to the reality and groundedness of George's vision." The thing is, they were completely wrong. Not only is Westeros a completely fictional world, but all it takes is one sitting in the medieval section of a library to realize that the Middle Ages were not the violent, ruthless, and bloody world they depict. The issue is too many people are under the assumption that the version of the Middle Ages depicted in the Game of Thrones is accurate. So you could just say, who cares? Even though this depiction of the Middle Ages isn't 100% accurate, it is clear that things are better off now than they were back then. Look at human progress, look at how far we've come, look at how technologically advanced, that must be something else entirely. This mentality is extremely dangerous. People tend to believe that social progress can be measured on a linear scale, Devil's Historians authors wrote. The fantasy of a white, Christian medieval past is a dangerously antiquated myth that has more to do with what some white people want the Middle Ages to have been than what they actually were. And it can be easy to say that only white supremacists want to believe that the Middle Ages were right and Christian, but when one looks at the current social injustices and political issues of our time, it is much easier to believe that society is the most socially progressive it has ever been than to critically look at the social injustices before us. Of course, the medieval ages were not perfect by any sense of the word, but people often use the word medieval to describe the developing world or accuse people's countries of being stuck in the Dark Ages, suggesting that they are backward, uneducated, or unusually violent. We should not pretend that we are much better off now than we were then. Not only are we erasing millions of histories and experiences when we exclude people of color from the medieval narrative, we are also denying the severity of our current social and political issues. So now it looks like our modern problem does not require a modern solution. Rather, our modern problem requires a medieval solution. When white supremacists hold up Confederate flags and belt out that they are entitled to their legacy, let's show them what their legacy is. A world in which people of color had been thriving in just as long as their white counterparts. The medieval era was not some utopia where issues like race, class, gender, and religion didn't exist. Nor should we ever pretend that it was. But we also cannot pretend that anyone who wasn't white, male, and Christian was a lifeless vessel bound to nothing by their oppression. People worked, lived, and thrived during this era. We must start depicting the Middle Ages for what they were, rather than what we might want them to be.